Let's move on. Now it's the last talk of the session. This is Professor Massimo Delia. He will talk to us about confinement and deconfinement in a magnetic background field. Massimo?
Yes, thanks a lot. So I'm sharing the slide. Okay, so I'd like to start by thanking the organizers for the invitation, and I apologize for joining the meeting, the workshop late because of I was lecturing before. So my talk will be about confinement and the confinement in magnetic background field, and the talk is mostly based on the following paper, which is not new. It is from a couple of years ago, but well, first of all, I think it has been presented before in a workshop only in a very preliminary stage. And the most important reason is that it is quite relevant to the study of the QCD phase diagram in a magnetic background. So, this is the reason I decided to discuss it in this context. And it will also be partially based on two other papers which regard the confinement properties in a magnetic background. So let me start from the questions at the basis of this study. Well, you know very well about the early lattice results regarding the phase diagram of QCD in a magnetic background, which were in some sense contrasting among themselves and among expectations from effective models. So the first result was obtained with two light flavors and two degenerate flavors with the standard staggered fermions and a standard discretization of the gauge action, with a pion mass of around 200 MeV and a quite coarse lattice. It was 10 years ago, and the result was for a temperature, a critical temperature, which was increasing with the magnetic field. That was in agreement with the most models, but then after a couple of years, there were new results from the Budapest and Wuppertal group using improved staggered fermions with an improved gauge action and with continuum extrapolated results, showing that instead the critical temperature was a decreasing function of the magnetic field. Now, at the same time, another striking difference was the behavior of the chiral condensate. Now, in both cases, the chiral condensate was growing with the magnetic field at low temperatures, but when considering the improved lattice results, there was a new phenomenon arising showing a non-monotonic behavior of the condensate around the critical temperature, in particular a decreasing behavior of the chiral condensate as a function of the magnetic field. And this has been so a sort of inverse magnetic catalysis to be compared with the standard magnetic catalysis expected at zero temperature. And for this reason, the unexpected decrease of TC of the critical temperature has been dubbed since then as inverse magnetic catalysis itself. Well, this non-monotonic behavior of the chiral condensate has been confirmed also by later studies, in particular with four flavors and staggered fermions in the SU2 gauge theory, or by using dynamical overlap fermions. Now, let me go to the question. The question, why the discrepancy? I mean, is the discrepancy, the original discrepancy, due to discretization effects or to the unphysical quark masses adopted in the simulation? So the unphysical quark masses, because the I mean, the original paper was our original paper was with a final mass of 200 MeV, while the improved results were obtained with the physical quark masses. And another question is if inverse magnetic catalysis is really the relevant phenomenon underlying the decrease of TC, or is it just a consequence of the decreasing of TC? Of course, since TC decreases, as you switch on the magnetic field, you move into the confined phase, and so you expect also the chiral condensates to decrease. So what is the relevant phenomenon, the really relevant phenomenon? So for this reason, we decided to undertake this investigation considering QCD with improved staggered quarks and also an improved action with 2+1 flavors, and by changing just the value of the pion mass in a range going from 300 MeV to 600 MeV. Now, let me say that there has been an analogous investigation obtaining consistent results from Gergely and the other people in this paper. Okay. So let me discuss at first the setup of our investigation. So of course, when you decide to study QCD with unphysical quark masses, since you are considering an unphysical theory, you have some freedom in the choice of your Bell parameters. So we decided to stay with the same lattice discretization. I will not go into details about the discretization, but it was the discretization with the 2+1 flavors, so two degenerate light flavors and a strange quark. With the staggered fermions with two levels of south smearing and a semantic improved gauge action. We decided to keep the strange to light mass ratio fixed at its physical value. So as we rise the light quark mass, we also rise the strange quark mass, keeping the ratio fixed. And we performed a set of preliminary runs to obtain the so-called lines of constant physics. I mean, the lines along which the pion mass is constant as you change the inverse gauge coupling beta and the Bell quark mass. Okay, and at the same time, we obtained the values of the lattice spacing, which is from where we derived the value of the temperature, which is the inverse of the temporal direction. And I remember that we have worked with a fixed value of the temporal extension, which is NT equal 6. So, okay, let me show you first some results that we obtained at zero magnetic field. So when you run at zero magnetic field and as you increase the value of the pion mass, what we observe looking at the chiral condensate is, of course, that and we consider the renormalized version of the quark condensate, which is the following, which subtracts both the additive and the multiplicative renormalizations. What you observe is, of course, that since chiral symmetry is less and less relevant as you increase the pion mass, is that the drop of the chiral condensate is more and more, less and less evident. Anyway, we derived the value of TC from the inflection point of the chiral condensate, and in a similar way also from the peak of the chiral susceptibility. And also from this plot, you can see that the strength of the chiral transition becomes weaker and weaker because chiral symmetry is less and less relevant to the physics of the system. So in this way, we obtain consistent determinations at zero magnetic field for the transition temperature, for the pseudocritical temperature, and well, just to see if the results were made sense, we tried to fit different values of the temperature for different values of the pion mass, including the physical one, with some function interpolating from the chiral regime up to the quenched regime. So setting a quenched temperature of 270 MeV, which is the value which is observed from pure gauge simulations, we managed to some way to fit all data, obtaining also a chiral extrapolation, which one should not take as a determination of the chiral temperature, but it is interesting that it is in the correct as a value which is consistent within a large error with known values, which are obtained with more precise determinations. Okay, so let me go to the results at non-zero magnetic field. So let me start from the results for the chiral condensate, for the normalized chiral condensate. And in this plot, you can see how the chiral condensate as a function of the temperature changes as a function of the magnetic field. I report values for three different magnetic fields, I mean zero magnetic field and two values of the magnetic fields, which are the same in all the three plots. Let me say just a few words about how these results have been obtained. So it has been stressed also in the previous talks that the magnetic field is quantized. So in lattice units, we had the magnetic field going along the z-axis. So since we have periodic boundary conditions, the magnetic field is quantized. So for a given value of the lattice spacing, you just have discretized values of the magnetic field. So since we have to change the lattice spacing as we change the temperature, it means that for a fixed quantum of the magnetic field, the physical value is changing. So what we did is to interpolate, to make a spline interpolation of values of all the observables, including the chiral condensate, the chiral susceptibility. We interpolated by spline interpolation the intermediate values to obtain, to interpolate the values at any value of the magnetic field we wanted. So in this way, we can manage to keep the magnetic field fixed in physical units while changing the lattice spacing as we change the temperature. So there are several things to be noticed already. We can see that at the lightest pion mass, we can still see inverse magnetic catalysis. I mean, the chiral condensate increases as a function of the magnetic field for low temperature. But then as you go around the critical temperature, around the inflection point of the chiral condensate, you see that the behavior is non-monotonic. I mean, there is a decrease of the chiral condensate around TC, but this decrease is less and less evident as you increase the pion mass. And finally, for the largest pion mass, you always see an increasing behavior. Okay, I will show later a more clear plot where this is more clearly visible. So the critical temperature from the chiral condensate is determined from the inflection point. I mean, it is not quite clear from the plot where the inflection point is. We fitted with various functions in order to determine the inflection point. The critical temperature is more visible by eye if you look at the chiral susceptibility, which is shown in the next plot. So this is the renormalized chiral susceptibility, which is defined in this way. Again, for different values of the pion mass and the different value of the magnetic field. From this plot, you can clearly see that the pseudocritical temperature shifts to the left, so to lower temperatures for all values of the pion mass as you increase the magnetic field. And you can also notice another interesting thing. I mean, that the height of the chiral susceptibility increases as a function of the magnetic field. which means that the strength of the transition increases. And another observable we analyze is the unrenormalized Polyakov loop. So in this case, we didn't perform a renormalization of the Polyakov loop. Anyway, also in this case, we determine the pseudocritical temperature from the inflection point of the Polyakov loop. Now, another interesting thing emerging from these plots is that in this case, for every value of the pion mass and for every value of the temperature, we have an increasing behavior of the Polyakov loop as a function of B. Okay. So this is in agreement with the previous results regarding the Polyakov loop, which are which were reported in this paper. Now, if we put together determinations obtained for TC from different observables, we see that the determinations are quite in agreement, considering either the chiral condensate or the Polyakov loop or the chiral susceptibility. This is, for instance, the determination of TC as a function of the magnetic field for the intermediate pion mass, 440 MeV. And this plot shows the main result of our study. I mean, the result that the critical temperature, the pseudo-critical temperature, is always a decreasing function of the magnetic field, and this happens independently of the pion mass. So you see here the different results for the different pion mass. Now, of course, you expect that at some point, when the quark mass goes high enough, quarks should decouple from the theory. So at some point, the magnetic field, since the only action, the only influence of the magnetic field on the system goes through the dynamical quarks, if the mass of the dynamical quarks is high enough, then the effect of the magnetic field should go away. And to explore this possibility, we computed for the different values of the pion mass what we call the curvature, which is analogous to the curvature of the pseudocritical line that you determine in the presence of a baryon chemical potential. So it is the coefficient describing the behavior of the pseudocritical temperature in the small b limit. So if I go back to the previous slides in this region, okay? And we determine this curvature coefficient both from our data and also from the original data at the physical value of the pion mass from the Budapest-Wuppertal collaboration. So these are the values that we obtained for the this curvature coefficient. And it is interesting to see that it behaves as expected. I mean, it is a monotonous function of the pion mass, which approaches zero, or I mean, the behavior is compatible with a function approaching zero as a power law with the, of the pion mass. Actually, our data are not precise enough for this curvature coefficient to give a definite statement about this behavior. I mean, we just wanted to check that it is compatible with some function which goes to zero in the limit of infinite pion mass. Okay, and it goes to zero without crossing, without going to negative values at any point. So our results are consistent with a curvature which is vanishing in the quenched limit, but with a critical temperature which is always a decreasing function of the magnetic field up to the quenched limit. Now, let me go back to the point whether we have a direct or inverse magnetic catalysis. And this is just a plot of something that I already showed before. So this is the difference in the chiral condensate with respect to its value at zero magnetic field. So you can see that at the lightest pion mass that we explored, 340 MeV, the chiral condensate decreases around TC. So we have the inverse magnetic catalysis phenomenon. This is still visible at 440 MeV, but then the phenomenon disappears at the highest values of the pion mass, so around 600 MeV. So in some way, you have that inverse magnetic catalysis disappears somewhere between 400 MeV and 600 MeV. And this is consistent with the more precise results obtained for this sort of switching value of the pion mass from inverse to direct catalysis, which has been located in this paper, later paper, around 500 MeV. Okay, this is the point where the inverse magnetic catalysis disappears, and nevertheless, the critical temperature still decreases. Now, actually, one should consider that there is a remnant of inverse catalysis, and this can be found in the so-called C contribution to the quark condensate. Now, you can decompose, in some sense, the difference that you observe in the chiral condensate as you switch on the magnetic field in two contributions, one which is due to the valence quarks and one which is due to the modification induced by the C quarks, by the dynamical quarks. And this C contribution is defined this way. I mean, you measure the chiral condensate by just changing by just inserting the magnetic field in the measured term of the path integral. So you keep the observable, so the trace of the inverse fermion matrix at zero magnetic field, and you just consider the modification induced at the level of the path integral measure. So in some sense, you just consider the effect of the magnetic field on the C quarks. And you can see from this picture that in this case, you always observe inverse magnetic catalysis in the C contribution. And these values I did not report in the picture, but have been obtained at the highest values of the pion mass. So at the value of the pion mass where you don't observe inverse magnetic catalysis in the total contribution to the chiral condensate. Anyway, in some sense, this is a direct manifestation of the fact that TC is decreasing. I mean, since TC is decreasing, it means that the distribution of the gauge fields is moving towards a distribution which is moving towards the phase with the I'm sorry, to the phase with the deconfinement and less chiral symmetry breaking. I mean, I wrote it the other way around. And so that means that the chiral condensate is decreasing, but just for the C contribution. So let me go to the first part of my conclusions. So we clarified that TC is a decreasing function of the magnetic field for any value of the pion mass, and likely up to the quenched limit, even if the dependence is milder and milder as the quarks decouple in the heavy mass limit. So in this way, we clarify that the discrepancy is in the earlier results on the dependence of TC on B was due just to discretization effects. Now, this has been confirmed also by recent results, which the reference is this one. In this paper, the authors considered again an improved staggered fermions, but with a different number of light flavors, with the three flavors, and they still report an increasing critical temperature as a function of the magnetic field, which means that in some sense, when you use standard staggered fermions and improved staggered fermions, we have this strong discretization effect resulting in an increasing critical temperature instead of decreasing. Well, another result is that inverse magnetic catalysis does not seem to be a universal phenomenon. I mean, as you go to very high quark masses, it disappears. On the other hand, what is always, in some sense, universal is the influence of the magnetic field on the confining properties. And well, this is already clear from the behavior of the Polyakov loop, which let me go back to the these slides. I mean, the only thing which is, in some sense, universal as you change the pion mass is the fact that the Polyakov loop increases as a function of the magnetic field. And this happens for all the temperatures and all the values of the pion mass. And this influence of the magnetic field on the confining properties is actually visible not only at zero temperature, but also when you consider zero temperature physics. And this is, I mean, a sort of appendix of my talk, last couple of slides. And I would like just to remind you about some results that we obtained a few years ago, which regard the effects of the magnetic field on the static quark-anti-quark potential at zero temperature. And you can consider the question of how the static quark-anti-quark potential is modified by the presence of the magnetic field. And the result is that there is a dependence of the static quark-anti-quark potential on the direction that you have between the quark-anti-quark separation with respect to the magnetic field. And in particular, we have an increase of the potential in the direction orthogonal to B and a decrease in the direction which is parallel to B. Okay. And when you consider also continuum, well, this is visible also at the level of the flux tube. I mean, you can also explore the flux tube and see how the modifications in the static quark-anti-quark potential can be seen at the level of the flux tube, which is formed between the quark-anti-quark couple. And you can see also in this case that the flux tube is suppressed when you consider a direction parallel to the magnetic field, and it is enhanced in the direction which is orthogonal to it. Now, the interesting thing is that when you try to extrapolate the in this plot, in the last plot, I show you the ratio of the string tension at non-zero magnetic field divided by the string tension at zero magnetic field, both in the orthogonal direction and in the parallel direction as a function of the magnetic field, then it, from this extrapolation, which is an extrapolation, I mean, our results are reliable till the region going up to 1 GV squared, in the sense that after that, since our lattice spacing in this case was the finest lattice spacing was 0.1 Fermi, we cannot trust results obtained for larger values of the magnetic field. But the extrapolation seems to point to a sort of, I don't know, a transition where the string tension in a direction parallel to the magnetic field would vanish. So, of course, this is just an extrapolation, but it is interesting because it is an indication and a suggestion for future studies. So, let me go to the last part of the conclusions. And the last part is that there is likely more to be explored in future lattice studies, and we have some studies in this direction going on regarding the link between the decreasing behavior of TC and the effect of the magnetic field on the confining properties, and the possibility that there is a sort of anisotropic deconfinement even at zero temperature for magnetic fields of the order of 10 GV squared. But of course, such high values of the magnetic field are not interesting from a phenomenological point of view, but of course the question is appealing from a theoretical point of view. Now, it is interesting to ask how these anisotropies, which are found at zero temperature, can be observed when we go to finite temperature. And maybe the most interesting phenomenon has been observed recently. Of course, it is related strongly to the chiral magnetic effect, and it is the enhancement of the electric conductivity, which is observed in the direction parallel to the magnetic field, with respect to the suppression which is observed for electric conductivity in the colloidal plasma, the direction which is orthogonal to the magnetic field. And another interesting observation is that the same order of magnitude of magnetic field, order of 10 GeV squared, is also where there is a prediction, which has been reported in the in this paper, for a possible QCD transition becoming the first order. Okay, the finite, in this case, the finite temperature transition becoming first order. Now, of course, exploring directly from lattice simulations magnetic fields of this order requires quite small lattice spacing in order to avoid finite cutoff effect, which are too large. And so I think this is something that we should explore in the future. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Massimo. Let me ask you a question first before handing out the session or to allowing more more questions. The results for the neutral pion mass, as reported recently, for instance, by Endrodi's group, show that the decrease of the pion mass as a function of the magnetic field is more, so to speak, prominent for the case when the pion, the vacuum pion mass decreases. But however, in your calculation, you're observing this transition between, say, the way the inverse magnetic catalysis shows itself for larger pion masses than lower than for lower pion masses. So the question is there any intuition what we can expect for the pion mass itself as a function of the magnetic field when you use non-physical pion masses, vacuum pion masses, and then you diminish them? Is the picture going to remain or not?
Now, this is a very interesting question. Unfortunately, we didn't study this in our paper. I mean, the pion mass we determined just at zero magnetic field. Okay, so then we proceeded with our simulations and we just investigated the behavior of the critical temperature. But yeah, I think it would be interesting to explore what is the effect on the pion masses along these different physical lines. And we didn't do that, but I think it is an interesting suggestion for future studies.
All right, thank you very much, Massimo.